Well, good afternoon. Welcome to the December 15th, 2015 meeting of the Northampton Transportation and Parking Commission. My name is Ryan O'Donnell. I'm the chair of the commission, also the counselor for Ward 3, and I know we have a quorum today, so I'll call the meeting to order. Let me announce the audio and video recording of the meeting, first of all, and let's start, as we always do, with introductions for the benefit of the public, starting with our vice chair.
I'm Elisa Klein, city councilor for Ward 7.
Dave Palmer is director of central services for the city.
Nancy Forrestall, assistant city collector.
Krista Burnett, citizen.
Dan Brooks, planning board.
Lynn Biden, planning sustainability.
Maggie Chan, public works.
Jody Casper, police department.
David Valletta, public works.
Terry Usho, DPW clerk.
Thank you very much. We start with a period of public comment. If you're here for an item that's further down on the agenda, you may wish to wait for that particular item, but you don't have to. You could speak twice if you want. If you want to speak on any subject during public comment, we ask you to keep it to about 3 minutes. Is there anyone here who would like to do something that's not on the agenda for the agenda? You might be here, Lola, for traffic.
Yeah.
Okay.
I haven't had a chance.
But seeing no public comment other than that, we'll launch into our agenda. Item number 3 is our minutes, first of all, and I'm going to ask the commission's indulgence to take our last minutes up in January because they're not quite ready. So without objection, we can do that. I would like to take things out of order because I think we do have people here today for specific items. And I'd like to jump right to item 9. Which is a recommendation on the use of existing traffic mitigation funds collected from projects in the Hockenham Road and Henry Street neighborhood. And I'll just give an introduction to this, if that's okay. Everyone has this little memo that I developed with Director Fiden, representing some options for spending money that has been collected in a traffic mitigation fund as a result of at least 3 building projects in this area. Oftentimes we require building projects to pay into a fund that we then spend, you know, connected geographically to that particular area on traffic mitigation. And this has been a subject of a lot of discussion in this part of Ward 3 among neighbors. And you can see that there are several options suggested in this memo. It doesn't mean that there may not be others or that others aren't possible to discuss today. What I would like to do, though, is use today as a public forum to make a recommendation, because these funds have been around for quite some time and they've gone unspent. And I just think that if we have traffic mitigation funds, we should spend them because it would be to the benefit of the neighborhood. So that's my goal. I'll briefly summarize for everyone else who may not have this in front of them some of the options that are on the table. Again, we're talking about $10,211.10. It's not exactly a princely sum. There's only so much you can build or purchase with that, and it's likely that depending on the option, you might supplement it with other funds as well. Option number 1 would be rebuilding sidewalks on Holyoke Street. My understanding is the affordable housing project that is likely going to go there at the lumberyard location, part of their proposal is to build sidewalks from Pleasant Street to the rail bridge. And we could potentially use this money to continue that, build sidewalks.
So theirs is much smaller. Theirs would only be their frontage on Pleasant Street.
Not on Holyoke Street.
Both, the frontage on Pleasant Street and Holyoke Street, but not the rest of the Holyoke Street frontage.
Okay, so but they would go not quite to the rail bridge then.
Right, and not quite to Pleasant Street.
Got it. Thank you for that clarification.
But the MassWorks grant, if we're going to reapply, we didn't get this year, we're going to reapply, that would go from Pleasant Street up to Holyoke Street.
Okay.
I mean, up to Holyoke Street.
But on Pleasant Street.
Both on Pleasant and on Holyoke Street.
Okay. But suffice it to say, it would complete the construction of sidewalks on Holyoke Street, which is a key pedestrian route. Another option and this actually sprung up for me anyway from residents who talked about this, would be a mini roundabout that would potentially be built at the intersection of Ventures Field Road, Montview, and Henry Street, because that's a difficult intersection generally. You have all these streets coming together in a strange way. Option three would be for a similar purpose, kind of bump outs and reshaping the curbs of that area for the same purpose of making traffic flow better, make it more safe at that location. Option four was another resident generated idea, which is street painting. Cities like Portland, Oregon, and Cambridge, Massachusetts have experimented with murals painted on the ground as a way to back slow traffic, because when you see them, you take note, at least the first time you see them, and maybe you slow down. And of course, we live in New England, and so there are weather concerns associated with street painting. That's option four. And a similar option to number one is option five, to be sidewalks on Hockin Road. So with that, if it's okay with the members of the commission, I'd like to start with comment from the public. I know there's people who have thoughts on this. And so at this time, I would invite anyone who wishes to comment on the use of this traffic mitigation money to come on up and give us your opinion. And if you'd state your name and address for the record, that would be helpful.
Oh, I'm Douglas Ross, and I live at 73 Barrett Street, and that's near the Big Y there. I didn't have a chance to look at all of your proposals, but I summarized through them as you were talking. And I think that, you know, with the limited amount of money that we have $10,000-something and some change, that's not a lot of money to do anything with. The best option is the most cost-effective option. Street painting, I just think that's just unnecessary. Bump outs, that's kind of unnecessary too, because then that kind of slows traffic down. You wanna, I think option two is the best one. That might be the most expensive one because it's a roundabout, and so it has to be constructed, but I think it's the most cost effective because you can put yield signs along the roundabout. Traffic can continue to flow. It's not gonna stop, you know, at a stop sign or whatever. You can build sidewalks around the roundabout for people to be able to walk, you know, from each side of the street or whatever. And so I think that's the best option. What's the other option that you had on here? Okay, so you said street painting one, and then sidewalks are going to be open. I have no objection to option one, the sidewalks, because I definitely do believe that this is a very biking and walking type of town. Lots of people ride bikes, lots of people walk to work. I do it myself. And it's just better to have bike lanes and sidewalks for people to be able to walk on. That way they're not in traffic, and that way they're not in danger of getting hit or whatever. Because as you all know, no offense, Massachusetts, but like, we're not really polite drivers here. Like, we're just not polite. So that's just my opinion.
Thank you very much.
Oh, you're welcome.
Any other comments? Ms. Reed?
I see that you have, under other items, this possible installation of stop sign on Henry Street, at the intersection of Henry Street and Ventures Field and Montview Avenue. And it seems to me that that might actually work. I mean, we know that people do go through stop signs if they think nobody's looking, but if there were more than one, though, I don't think that one would do it. I think it would have to be two or even three at that intersection. I love the idea of street paintings. I was the first co-chair person of the traffic calming commission when we first started. 2007, I just looked it up. At the end of 2007, and so we've been working on these for a long time, trying to calm the traffic in our neighborhood. As you probably know, we did, after many years of work, and I'm talking about meetings with Laura Hansen, walks with Laura Hansen to make determinations about the neighborhood. meetings with the entire neighborhood, going door to door and leaving, talking to people and getting people's signatures. I mean, we had to go through a lot to get anything done. This was, you know, a while back. It seems like the process is simpler now. But what we finally got was a yellow stripe on the curb between Pomeroy Terrace and William Street, which helped to keep the people on that dangerous curb in their own lanes. And we got 4 speed humps. Now, the speed humps really do work. People really do have to slow down. Some people bump over them at a higher speed, but most people slow down. The only problem that we have in that neighborhood with the speed humps is there are too few. We have 2 on William Street, on the north end of William Street, I'm talking about from Holyoke Street up. And those, excuse me, we have 1 on that end of William Street, and 1 just as you turn the corner from Holyoke Street to William Street. So 1 on William Street in on the north end and 1 on the south end. It's just not enough. People go over them and then they start to speed up again. They're very, very effective, but they're not, there aren't enough of them. I think probably there are enough on Holly Street because that's a shorter street. You know, I would love to see one on Holyoke Street because people come off the highway, zooming down Pleasant Street, turn right on Holyoke Street, and they're still on Route 91. And so, you know, if there was some way to slow down the traffic there, I think that would help. Sidewalks, I think, are part of the infrastructure of the town or the state. It doesn't seem like we should be using our mitigation money for something as big as a project like that. I would love to see that happen, but I don't think it should happen with our money. Thank you.
Other questions for Ms. Reed?
Since you have what appears and sounds to be a very good historical perspective on that neighborhood and issue, so I'm hearing speeding is definitely an issue.
Yeah.
Any other issues that might help in deciphering how we might spend that money?
No, that's the major issue. I mean, you know, of course, it's, you know, safety in terms of people crossing the streets and walking down the streets. But as far as I know, we haven't had any accidents in that realm. We actually used to have more accidents on William Street, car to car, before the speed hump. So I'm sure that it's helping in that regard too. But maybe some more crosswalks would be helpful as well, especially on those crucial corners like William Street and Holyoke Street. And maybe even Ventura's Field, maybe that would be helpful there, I don't know. That's a couple of blocks away from me, so the people in that closer to that intersection would be able to answer that question. By the way, I'm Lola Reed, and I live on William Street.
Thank you.
And I was remiss, by the way, were there any questions for Mr. Ross, who first gave a public comment? And I'll just return to
People can actually talk to me? That's wonderful. I'm so used to...
We're not polite drivers, but we're polite. other members of the public? Mr. Mesh.
Hi, my name is Jim Nash. I live at 18 Montview. The words that Lola shared. Lola and a number of neighbors went through a lot of work 7-8 years ago. It was very extensive, lots of meetings with neighbors, put together a number of recommendations, and some of them, by and large, I don't think the city was ready for a number of them at the time. One of them was the speed humps, and that kind of fit in. That was the new idea. We were trying to speed homes back then, and they went through. There was also ideas around painting a mural and in one of the intersections, and that met a lot of resistance. So one of the first things I want to suggest is taking some, I'd like to see some of the money set aside for a mural. I know a number of neighbors are supportive of this idea, and that since we've gone through the discussion with the Rainbow Crosswalk, which kind of, you know, we now are entertaining different things in our streets other than white lines. So my suggestion would be to set aside maybe $1,200 or whatever to budget for neighbors to do that project. I'd like to say that I, you know, there's the proposal on the table of rebuilding the Holyoke sidewalk and Holyoke Street sidewalk. And I have reservations about the money going to that. And mainly because as I've been thinking it through, it's like, hold it, the whole street needs to be rebuilt. And that that if we were to simply just replace the sidewalk at this point, by the way, the sidewalk's about this wide. So to replace it, you know, without doing a study of the street, where the actual boundaries are and how wide the actual sidewalk should be, you know, then you're starting to say, well, how wide should the street be? And in fact, shouldn't there be sidewalks on the other side of the street? Holyoke Street is actually the entrance street to my neighborhood, the William Street area. And one side features a narrow sidewalk, and the other side features no sidewalk, with people parking all over the lawns. There's a nice big dumpster right up on the street. And of course, we have the railroad bridge, which we've been trying for years to get painted. But I just, that this money, the way it was brought to us, was this is money that you can use to creatively to slow traffic in your neighborhood. And so that's where the speed humps and the murals, that's what I'm supportive of. I'd also like to say that within our neighborhood, we now have new zoning. We are the infill area. The city has decided that densities are to go up. We are already a very dense neighborhood. And this is the only money we've been talking about for 10 years to improve the infrastructure of our neighborhood. You know, this traffic mitigation money. But, and by the way, the new zoning makes it harder for traffic mitigation money to happen. The project that has been proposed over off of Holly Street for the senior housing, that is, that's a zoned central business. There's no parking requirements and likely no traffic mitigation lines. The project will, you know, while the people have talked about being helpful with the neighborhood, which is great, so we've given up ways to leverage out the money we're talking about today. So what I would like to see is a way to that we start having policies that if this is the infill area and we want greater density, that we need to have policies in place that puts funds so that we're actually talking about rebuilding not just Holyoke Street sidewalk, but all of the sidewalks within the area, as well as the streets. As far as the neighborhood, I would like to see a traffic study done in terms of what exactly we need. We have signs that are missing from intersections. We have the rebuild of Pomeroy has been terrific. We have lines, we have crosswalks. If the rest of the neighborhood could reflect like that, that would be a great improvement in safety. But we need to have the studies done. I noticed on the list there's the study of Ventures Field and Henry Street and Montview. I think that's great. But I think all of these intersections need to be looked at and studied. They're basically farm roads. In fact, Henry Street used to be Ventures Field Road, and it's been there for over 200 years, except when they built the dike, They cut it up, and Henry Street's still a farm road. No sidewalks, and is probably about 16 feet wide. So I've rambled a bit here. Thanks for listening to what I've had to say. So the things I'd like to see are set aside money for a mural, and I'm interested in speed humps, and I'm interested in policies to really address this stuff more so than this money. Thank you.
Thank you. Other questions, Mr. Nash? I would just note that, as you know, some of this money has already been spent to install the two speed bumps on William Street.
Yes, and it was very little cost. To get four speed humps in, I think, was something like $4,000. Do you remember, Wayne?
I think they're $2,500 a piece.
Okay. About $1,000. It really was not very much money, so we certainly could use at least a portion of this remaining $10,000 to put in more speed humps, which seem to be effective.
Okay.
And by the way, there are none on Pomeroy Terrace. I don't live on Pomeroy Terrace, so I don't know if those double yellow lines and all the parking along there is keeping the speed down, but.
Well, so recently Pomeroy Terrace itself was one long speed bump.
Yeah. Oh yes, I loved it. I loved it.
Councilor Klein.
I didn't mean to interrupt you, but.
No, please.
I have two kind of general questions. One is up until the very end when Mr. Nash mentioned the Montview Henry Ventress Field intersection, I didn't hear from anyone that was one of the main concerns. So I'm curious to hear from the residents of the neighborhood if that feels like a more of a backseat kind of worry.
Well, I did mention that I would like to see stop signs there.
Oh, you did. I'm sorry.
And I don't live on that end, but I do know several people who do, and they are very concerned about that intersection. Jim lives near it.
Yeah, I'm surprised at the turnout today. I was expecting a lot more people. And there are a number of people who are very concerned about that intersection.
Okay.
But
that's good to know. Sorry, you did mention that. I'm sorry.
That's okay.
And then the other question actually kind of is directly related to what Jim was just saying. I'm just curious about the internal process in the neighborhood. Has Wayne, did you do anything with that neighborhood to kind of rank the interest at the different intersections and that kind of thing? And is that going to be done, or has it been done internally?
Laura was really doing that process with the neighborhood.
But that's years ago, so you haven't updated that process.
Right. Well,
sorry.
If I can interject, we did do a whole public forum on this issue. Gosh, when was it? March or something. And we had a number of people turn out, and we sort of, you know, distilled what we heard and wrote it down. And this kind of represents largely what I heard. Although speed bumps might have also been mentioned, and they're not on here, I don't recall. But there was that public forum done earlier in the year.
But without a ranking of desire.
Yeah, it was more just to collect ideas and bring them together, as I recall.
It seems to me that it would be useful to get that kind of specificity of how many people want each of those pieces done, each of those pieces done.
Councilor Sherrod, did you have?
Yeah, I was going to save this till the agenda item, but since Councilor Klein was asking, I don't live in that neighborhood, but I'm at that intersection four times a day.
Which happened. One?
Of the Montview Henry Ventures, and have been for 4 years now, and I think a stop sign, particularly at Henry, would be really, really useful because cars cannot, when they get to that point, they can't see what's coming down Montview, and I've almost been in multiple accidents, and cars are just always like zipping down, but they just kind of all converge to that point, and there's not a lot of visibility. So I love that the stop sign is on the agenda for tonight. That's a good idea.
Thank you. Mr. Lapinski, and then, since he hasn't spoken yet, then we can go back to Mr. Ross.
So, my name is Jasper Lapinski. I now live at 43 West Street, but I lived in that neighborhood for 3.5 years, and one of my favorite things to do was to take a walk that more often than not led me through pretty much all the intersections that we're talking about, and so I have opinions about all of them. So first thing that I'm going to say, and I have a very large amount of respect for the people who have already spoken, but I'm very passionately opposed to speed humps, ever, in any case. And particularly, the reason that I feel that way is because speed humps make me feel, as a pedestrian, very unsafe. Here's why. If someone is maintaining a speed, it is much easier for them to see a pedestrian and slam on the brake than if they are accelerating. Speed humps means that you, as a driver, particularly if you're an antsy driver like the ones that we're trying to address, I don't think we're trying to address Lola's driving, right? These drivers are the ones that are just going to be ramming on the gas pedal as soon as they get over the speed hump, or maybe even not as soon as they do. That's when they're going to hit me. They're not going to hit me when they're going 30. They're going to hit me when they're getting up to 30. So every speed hump makes the pedestrian less safe. It also wastes a lot of gasoline, and therefore it makes, you know, the entire world less safe with the additional carbon emissions. But that's what I'm going to say on speed humps. If you want to fix the William Street, Holyoke Street intersection, all you have to do is take the stop sign off of Holyoke Street and put one on both sides of William Street, because nobody can see anyone. A stop sign is meaningless if once you come to a stop, you can't see who's there, right? So if you put the stop sign on William Street, then the visibility is no longer an issue. How you fix Pomeroy Terrace is you close the corner to traffic. Nobody needs that corner. There are no driveways on that corner.
Which corner? Sorry to interrupt.
Williams and
just a little curve, what kind of
the one that has the new yellow line where you come down Pomeroy and then you have to sort of do the zigzag. The reason that we need traffic mitigation is because there's too much traffic. Most of the cars on Pomeroy Terrace have no business being there. They think that if they go 40 miles an hour down Pomeroy Terrace, they will beat the traffic. But they won't, because they'll end up stuck in a long line of cars that can't make a left off of Holyoke Street. But because they think that they're on that street, they have no business being there. That corner doesn't need to be open to cars. Maybe keep it open for the fire department. There's probably a way to do that. But that doesn't need to be open. There are no driveways on it. There's no reason anyone would ever need to drive on it, except in an emergency. I don't have a solution to the one that is with Henry Street and the other ones. I would suggest that a roundabout there would look a little silly, but I guess probably not a lot of people would notice, except the people that live there. When I walk down there on a daily basis for years on end, I never noticed anything really dangerous or problematic, but on that I'm not gonna say that my experience is better than anybody else's. And if you want to do something there, that's fine. I don't know that a mural would help, is what I'm going to say on that. But I'm going to just circle back to the beginning and say every speed bump makes me as a pedestrian less safe.
Thank you. Other questions for Mr. Lefkowitz? Okay. Thank you. Before we get Mr. Ross, you still have a comment? I wanted to just offer something that might focus the debate on this. The reason why stop signs are kind of pulled out of this and are not in the memo, they're separate on the agenda, is because they are just different in a number of ways. There are a number of state warrants that have to be met for stop signs, and I would imagine that the stop sign itself is the problem with a barrier is not the expense. The stop sign isn't the sign. And so with the traffic mitigation funds, I'd like to focus our conversation on what might be done with them. And signage is kind of not part of that in terms of stop signs. Is there anyone else? Mr. Ross, do you want to dive in?
Yes. I'm listening to Jim and Jasper and people talk. These proposals, to me, in my personal opinion, sounds like they're band-aids to me, that we're trying to put band-aids on, because it seems like it's this whole area seems to be like a big issue that needs more than $10,211. Seems like it needs 10, even 12 times that amount to address all of the issues that are being brought up, because I'm hearing, you know, about people walking down the street and being at risk of being hit, and you know, there's not driveways, and you know, the sidewalk is just, you know, too small, and then just like building that sidewalk is not working because then the whole street needs to be repaired. So I'm wondering, I have two questions. My first question is this money required to be spent before the end of your fiscal year?
No, hopefully it's spent before the end of our lifetimes.
Okay.
It's been sitting there for a long.
Okay. Is there any way that you can add money to this? Like, from example, from like unused money from, I don't know how the city budget is, if there's any money in the city budget reserve, but like your rainy day funds or any unused money, is there any way you can transfer that unused money onto this to add more money to it so you can better able to address the issue?
In many cases, like for example with sidewalks, we probably would supplement it with other funds. So, yeah, $10,000 by itself is, you know, of limited utility, obviously. And also just a broader comment, I mean, there's so much in the works in this area in terms of what we're planning on Pleasant Street, a potential Mass Works grant we're applying for. I'll just start editorializing now. One of the things I like about sidewalks and connecting to Pleasant Street is it seems like that would sort of show that we're making the city's investment, and hope that might actually make us more likely to secure a grant from the state. I don't know. But it's a big interconnected issue. And even within this memo, which is fairly narrow, you hear some comments about Ventures Field and Henry and Montview, very different from the end of William Street, where we may need another speed bump, very different from Holyoke and even Hockenham. And so I think a big challenge of this is how few people can we disappoint with our decision? Because surely we will disappoint some, just because everyone has different concerns based on where they live. But the point I like to make, and it's to Mr. Ross's point, once this money is spent, that's not the end of our traffic calming work as a city. I agree we need to do more on traffic calming in general. And I think it's clear we're stepping up our efforts in the Pleasant Street corridor in particular. So I just want to make the point that whatever the outcome is today, it's not going to be done in isolation, and I expect there to be more conversation in the future in this commission and in the community.
Can I clarify something? Yeah. Question to the commission, do we have a mandate or some kind of decision making that we need to do with regard to this, or is this something that we are returning to the neighborhood with a particular staff member that needs to kind of oversee their process? I mean, what essentially are we tasked with doing here with regard to this today?
So, yeah, I mean, so generically, the way this fund is set up is planning can spend money on design and planning without going back to council. To do bricks and mortar projects requires going back to council. This committee, 6 years ago, voted to say there's not a lot of money here, you're happy to authorize DPW to spend it as they see fit in accordance working with the neighborhood. That's what started this process with Laura. And then if I could do my editorializing as part of this, I mean, you know my perspective on the plan, I was in comprehensive planning, but this is the smallest fund we have for traffic mitigation from any project, and the one that's been hanging around the longest. And to some extent, I think there's a role for comprehensive planning. But when it's $10,000, I think it's find something that does good and spend it and build momentum, come back later with a bigger project. It's not very much money, so we do something, and we should just do that. I'm just frustrated because it's been 9 years or 10 years.
But again, is there some decision-making piece that we need to do today? Is this something that the planning department is going to follow up with the neighborhood to, so some implementation happens?
We can. I mean, sort of, when Laura took it over, whatever it was, years ago, we haven't been involved, you know, other than the meeting that Brian asked for last year. So we can. I haven't been involved with anything up here other than sort of request. So it's not our cue. I'm happy to. I just think it's small enough piece I'm going to find something on this list that sounds good, and let's do it.
My hope is that we have, we're an advisory body, of course, so we can only make recommendations. We can make a recommendation that's utterly ignored. It probably wouldn't be, since we have department heads and this kind of thing as members of the commission, but it's my hope we can make a recommendation in this commission to guide the spending of the money as soon as possible. Ms. Reed?
I just would like to put in a plug for a neighborhood meeting that would bring in more than three or four people from the neighborhood. We have had this kind of meeting in the neighborhood with Laura Hansen, with the traffic engineer, and everyone was notified by signs. I can't remember if we would just put up posters or we went door to door with little flyers. I think we may have done that at least for one of the meetings. And then anyone who didn't come to that meeting just doesn't have a say in it. A lot of people can't make it to a 4 o'clock meeting downtown or don't know about this meeting. Thank you, Jim, for sending out a notice to some of us in the neighborhood, not everybody in the neighborhood, but the ones that you had access to in terms of their emails. But I think to make it a more democratic process and find out what the neighbors really want, we have to get more neighbors involved.
I think we can make recommendation, but I would really encourage that kind of process that you're talking about, Ms. Reed. And up in where I live in Leeds on Yankee Hill, we had traffic mitigation money, and a shout out to the planning department, to Wayne. We coordinated together with him a meeting, and it was exactly that, the people were invited. We did a very aggressive kind of outreach to folks, made it clear that we would be kind of voting and ranking on which projects people in the neighborhood were interested in, and we're moving forward with those decisions. And I think that that is the most democratic way to do it, and it really is informed, of course, by the people who are most affected. So I'd love to see that kind of process happen. I'm not even sure that we necessarily need to make a recommendation. It sounds like we've boiled it down to some basic ideas, and we can hand the process back.
You're talking about a lot of needs, and you're talking about a little money. And that probably only works if you hierarchy it and then start to spend the money knowing full well that you're not going to do everything in one shot. You're going to knock away at it. You're not doing everything in leads in one step, are you? No, you're taking it as you get resources for it, which is what you would be doing if you followed that model, I would think. And the $10,000 would go the first place where you can actually plug $10,000 in your hierarchy and make something happen. Might not be the top priority. It probably wouldn't be the top priority, but it would, at least something would happen under those circumstances.
Chief?
I think it would help with the decision-making process too if we had any idea of the cost of these things. Do we have that information? That's just, that would have an impact on any decision making I would make or any recommendations. I don't buy a lot of sidewalks. I'm interested, but do we have any idea what the cost is for these different options?
I guess, well, maybe Director Fiden does, but I mean, not hard numbers, no, just kind of ballparks. But we could certainly, you know, that we could gather that information if that was.
Well, unless we know that there's supplemental funds, you talked about using supplemental funds out of the DPW, if those are available, and one is, I don't know how much a sidewalk costs. I mean, is it $50,000 versus a mural, which seemingly would be, you know, someone mentioned $1,200, that seems, those are big differences. If we have the money that's there, regardless of, if you think these are all warm enough and they're affordable, that would have an impact on decision making for me.
Okay, I think it's a valid point. On mural, briefly, I mean, one of the things about a mural is that it wears away. And so funding for a mural might have to be a multi-year fund to maintain it.
Yeah, I don't put the chief on the spot, but when it just came up before and suggested was the feeling we need a police detail. And that would add substantially the cost of people coming out there. I'm not sure if there's a way around that.
I hear you.
Yeah.
And there may be, actually. I mean, it depends on where it is. Because if you can close a road without requiring a detail, certainly we'd be happy to help out in whatever way we could. It would depend on which project we're talking about. I can envision with the mural there being very little, if any, cost because we could close off roads, at certain ends.
That'd make a big difference.
Yeah. Just with the appropriate signage would probably be fine. Okay. Some of the other ones that, would probably require a detail. It depends.
Yeah.
Okay. Does anyone know how long ago did we do the rainbow crosswalk and how much maintenance has that needed?
I think that was in 2014.
Please direct your questions through me.
Oh, sorry.
No, that's okay. So, I don't know.
No, it was, okay. VMU, it was May of 2014.
I heard. And how much maintenance, how many times has it needed to be repainted in those years? Any?
Zero.
Depends on the quality of the paint that you use. We had a whole discussion about this in this commission.
Paint wears off road, so. Well, Ms. Forrestal had her hand up.
We have heard from many neighborhoods and community members about mitigation and traffic calming. And it seems to me that again and again and again, we hear people requesting the speed humps, and that this has been a common item that has come up. And with $10,000, it would seem to me that if we're going to make the greatest impact with that very limited amount of money, that you would get the greatest impact with the speed bumps because you could do them in several roads. Let's say they're $3,000 a piece. So you have three of them. You might have a little extra money left over, whatever. But instead of putting a little dab of money towards a big project, why not make as great an impact as possible? And it would seem to me that the speed pumps we could actually afford a few of them with that amount of money. And we're hearing that. We're hearing that request.
And I would say I've heard also, I've received by email and at a recent meeting of the Ward 3 Neighborhood Association, at least two comments in favor of Hoyoke Street sidewalks too, for the same reason, that you could just kind of build them. So those are comments. People are not here today, but I have heard those comments as well. One question I'd have is if we're going to install a speed bump, would we still need to go through the traditional traffic calming application process, except in this case you would have funding attached to it, which might bump it up in the queue.
We don't need to go through the process for traffic mitigation unless you're trying to cap all the funds that are out there. But if you're doing something just for the 10,000, it does need to go to traffic mitigation, the traffic calming.
May I ask a quick question that certainly would educate me? The difference between traffic calming and traffic mitigation. I mean, is the point of this to reduce the volume of cars, in which case pedestrian options make sense like sidewalks, or is it used interchangeably with slowing the rate of traffic, in which case speed bumps make more sense?
This is more about where the money comes from than what the projects are for. So traffic mitigation are fees that we're collecting from developers when they're adding traffic to the area. And it can be used for anything which reduces traffic or slows the city traffic and makes it safer. And more often than that, we're for the most part not getting that much mode shift, but we're more likely to get people going slower. We have spent a lot of traffic mitigation money in bike paths because that does actually do some mode shift.
Mr. Heafy, did you have a...
We'll direct this to the chair.
Hopefully, I know the answer.
Washington Avenue. I thought the chief made a really good point to figure out how you spend $10,000, which is a starting point. What is the cost of these five options? And the question that went through my mind as I listened to this is, what was the cost of the estimated initial cost of a roundabout on Prospect Street near Butler and Elwins and Woodlawn Avenue versus what they put in? And I would think you need to know the cost of these to say, okay, so many bucks to spend. Only cost each of these options without dreaming for the sky when realistically you can't do that. cost of each kind of thing is important to assess. Just a thought.
No. Fair point. Thank you. I don't see anyone.
So part of the frustration from the neighbors is they feel like they put this to bed a number of years ago with Lola's group, and it was handed off to DPW. The recommendations that they put forward were based on what the budget could afford, speed humps, murals. They didn't look a lot at sidewalks or anything like that because those were all deemed out of the budget. And so that's why those type of recommendations came forward. And I think that's another reason, because a lot of people feel like this was already done, to re-engage people is kind of hard. There's this circular thing going on where, you know, you guys are wanting feedback, but the neighbors already feel like they gave you the feedback. There's a report over at DPW that's like 46 pages long. So, you know, personally, I'm comfortable with you guys picking any one of those things on there today. If you would like to have feedback, the Neighborhood Association could help organize some sort of event. But.
Well, I appreciate those comments. I have to say, though, that we held a whole forum about this earlier in the year, and there's been continual discussion in the Ward 3 Neighborhood Association. And now we're having another forum. So, I mean, we could have more. But again, it's $10,000. So,
well,
just
something
and, people, and also, if there, just if I may, this report, I mean, I would love to see it. And certainly, it sounds lengthy. I don't know if it had any simple conclusions about what the money should be spent on.
I think it merely outlined different options for DPW to consider. And it was the original traffic study report done by a neighborhood. It was the first. And that's how long this money has lingered.
Another point I'd make is that when we say the neighborhood, it's very important, but it must involve the general public, because at the end of the day, it's public. So there cannot be private meetings. Just important to point that out.
These meetings were done with staff. So, you know.
Okay.
But I think if you're holding meetings like this, you can see what the turnout's gonna be. That's you know. So.
Well, okay. Counselor, and then we'll make an effort to wrap up, perhaps.
That would be good.
Okay.
I'm just concerned about the time. We have a pretty full agenda. I appreciate hearing that history, Jim. I didn't know that history. But I do think, I mean, I use the example of what we did in Leeds, thanks to the planning department, because it was a really efficient process. We had a one-time meeting, and we're proceeding with what was determined. And I'm not really clear on why, you know, years ago this report was developed, we're considering it here, we're talking about another public meeting. I mean, I brought up the idea of a public meeting because I didn't know that that had been done. But what the piece that I think is missing is the citizen input on the ranking of the desire for which of these things. And if the decision is not to do it that way, then I think we should do it here, but I think we should just do it because it just does seem like this has become a repetitive and not very useful process. And I'm a little bit unclear as to why this has happened when the process that we didn't need was so brief and so successful. So
just sort of background, so Ryan asked to organize a meeting in the winter sometime last year, and we didn't have a great turnout. So that was the idea of the meeting, and it was small enough to be more as a discussion session, but not, we didn't do sort of the formal dot vote or whatever we did in Leeds because it was closed. So.
Ms. Pomerantz.
I don't mean to move on the agenda, but just to respond to your point, Lisa, it's mid-December, so even if we were to come up with an option 1, 2, and 3 today, based on these 4 or 5 options, we're looking at spring to really implement this, so it does give everybody time to want to do the neighborhood meeting and resurrect or continue the discussion. Because you're not looking at implementing these at this point in the calendar year. So So use the time of the year as an impetus to get the decision-making made.
Well, I would accept the motion if someone wants to make a motion to recommend any of these options or make a motion to have no recommendation at this time.
I would make a motion that we have a recommendation. I think it's a small amount of money and people would appreciate a decision.
Okay. Do a particular...
Which one?
there's the problem. There's the traffic hump.
To paraphrase. I would make a motion to go with the speed humps. I think it's a clean, easy, good use of the money that would have a direct impact if it would slow traffic down. I think it's been successful on other streets. We've seen it be successful, and I think it would have an impact on the neighborhood.
And that would be on William Street.
I just want to second that, but I want to do a caveat if I can, which is speed humps are inexpensive if you don't have to change the drainage. They're really expensive to change the drainage. So I think it would be a lot of flexibility for DPW to say, here's a street where, in an area where people are driving, put the speed humps where you don't need to redo the drainage, which is going to limit the locations, but it makes the cost affordable. Mm.
So could the motion be that we're making a recommendation for the DPW to bring us an honest assessment of how we could put in a speed bump at the end of William Street, where there currently is none. When we recommend a speed bump, but we want to take their engineering analysis into account. So the motion is to recommend speed bumps to that location, pending analysis from the DPW.
That seems solid.
Okay. Any discussion on this particular motion? In this particular, Mr. Blair.
I understand the desire to try to resolve this and come to some sort of conclusion, but it now seems to be perhaps drawn to the other extreme, which is if you talk about having one speed bump, if you think costs about $2,500, now you're left with an even sillier amount that's not spent. So if there's going to be a recommendation for speed bumps, I thought we were talking about multiple speed bumps, so we'd be able to actually spend this money that's been hanging around since 2010 or 20. For 10 years. That's a comment.
So, right, we're voting on one speed bump.
Maybe I wasn't clear because we've been all kind of contributing to the motion, but let's say three speed bumps, assuming that they're all within that price range that we think that they are, and then it would be up to the with good skills and knowledge to decide exactly where they would be to be the most effective and the least costly, so that we use most of the funds and have the biggest bang for our buck.
But you guys saying having many speed bumps the money covers?
Around three or four. That would be my motion, the full number of speed bumps that we can buy and trust the DPW and the city to decide where they go exactly in those neighborhoods.
Okay. And I would offer another friendly amendment to that, because when you put in speed bumps, you put it in front of someone's house and suddenly they're not in favor of speed bumps anymore because people are making noises when they go over them. So if we do that, I think we do need to actually have another community discussion at some point. So I would also add that to the motion that we not only consult the DPW, but we need to consult the community in some ways, just as we normally do in the process by getting signatures from the neighborhoods. Councilman?
I'm also a little concerned that we're talking about the methods and we're not talking about the locations. And we did confirm today that the Henry Montview Ventress Field intersection is one of the concerns, and I'm not sure, you know, where a speed bump could go that would address that. So I think that we've got to think a little more holistically. I'm not against, you know, saying yes, speed bumps, but I think that we're not thinking holistically in terms of location as well.
I think that's a good point. I mean, I actually share that concern. We don't exactly know what speed bumps are going to be going, so.
I guess my own thing, I'm willing to trust DPW to figure that out. So I think you're right, I think they need to come up with a plan. I'm not sure that we need to come up with a plan.
But if we're making recommendations, I think we need to address at least one of the main concerns in terms of location that we heard here, which is that particular intersection.
Maybe if I can make the suggestion, then we'll finally, hopefully, vote on this motion. Maybe the motion can simply be that we recommend the money be spent on traditional traffic, traditional traffic calming device, like a speed bump, and that would be the extent of it. And then we won't prescribe anything more than that. So they don't have to prescribe exact locations for speed bumps. So.
I would want to make a friendly amendment to that, though, that does say that some attention needs to be paid to that particular intersection.
Which?
The Mockbee Henry intersection.
All right. We have a complicated motion on the floor. The chief made it. Can I prevail on the chief to just restate it?
Yeah, so I'll make a motion that the money is spent on speed humps, the number that we can afford within the allotted amount of money, mm-hmm. and they will be installed in areas that are recommended by the city based on their assessment of safety and expense.
Okay, with as much citizen input as possible. Okay, and that motion's been seconded. Any further debate on it? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? So what are abstentions? Okay, the motion passes. Thank you very much. All right. Well, that's one agenda item. I dispense with that. We have a lot to do. We're not going to cover very much of it, to be perfectly honest. And we also have a meeting that's beginning today at 6 o'clock in this location. I would like to move very briefly to, hopefully briefly, to DPW updates, if there are any to share.
So Warner Brothers, the contractor, they have stopped for the winter, but they'll be back this spring for doing small business and others. The traffic control devices contract on Bridge Road, the hang out after the flashing beacons and signal flashing beacons are now functioning. They're most of troubleshooting. Main Street, westbound, turning on Carter Street. Dedicated left turn arrows have been installed. And the final inspection for all the traffic control devices that have been installed there will be an inspection on Friday for these things. for traffic calming, Nonotuck Street, I've put out counters in four different locations within 2 weeks, and that's been completed. I just need to process the data.
Thank you very much. Any questions, Ms. Chair?
I'm wondering if you did the processing of North Main.
I should have that for next month.
Is it possible to get it
that
before
out.
Then?
Yeah, I'll send that out.
Thanks.
Anything else on DPW updates? Okay. We'll move on then. Any subcommittee updates from Bicycle and Pedestrian Subcommittee?
Kind of two grants we got from the government that is sort of related to specified. So we wanted to do a pedestrian bicycle plan for a while. This committee has talked a lot about a crosswalk and sort of thought that's part of that, doing it as an overall pedestrian plan. We applied for a bunch of grants and expected not for them all to come through, and we actually ended up with more grants than we expected. So we about to hire a contract with Alta Design to do a citywide comprehensive pedestrian and bicycle master plan, and that will include looking at all the crosswalks in town. They're not doing designs for all the crosswalks. They're going to look at all the crosswalks and say, you know, these 50 should be treated this way and whatever, but at least they're going to be looking at them all. This is it's a big grant, so it's very exciting. It has a very aggressive timeline in terms of the grant, so they have to do a fair amount of spending the money by March 29th and then finish the entire project by September 29th. So that sort of range. That was the biggest grant, the $100,000 grant. And then we had two separate grants adding up to $50,000. We're using PVPC, and they're mostly really focused on getting people who don't generally come to public meetings tenant input. So seniors and low-income neighborhoods and people of color to get them involved in the process. But they'd be working together, so PVPC and all to be working together on the project. And it's going to include, some of you have probably seen the street design manuals, a lot of cities have, rural areas, urban areas. We're going to do a street design manual that's sort of more generic for complete streets. And part of it is, the mayor authorized us about 6 months ago to look at all of Main Street and doing redesign for Main Street. Big project, big ticket item. And we realized that we weren't ready for the engineering for it because some of the issues are programmatic. So like, you know, if we drop a lane, for example, is that extra distance, is that extra width for bus lane, or is that for a bicycle lane, or is that for wider sidewalks? Those aren't really engineering issues. Those are sort of normative value issues. So this study will help us sort of do community meetings and figure out what do we want. And then on September 29th, we'll go to the actual design. So that's all that main piece. And then we also got a grant from the same source to do wayfinding signage. And this is sort of a pilot study. This is looking at, are there places to do wayfinding which will make people think distances are shorter? So we talked about this when all the bike paths were built. One thing that really struck me is a lot of people said, oh, I didn't realize I was so close from this point to that point, that maybe I can bicycle or walk faster and get driven around. And so that's sort of the focus on this, looking at places close to bike paths, places within a mile of Florence, and places within a mile of downtown. And basically just, you know, science, you're only a 5-minute walk to this location. So we're hiring Walk Boston for that project. It's sort of going to be a donut, so we're not looking at downtown itself, because the mayor has in his capital plan to do a wayfinding program for downtown. A lot of this is parking related. This comes out of the parking study. So in an ideal world, we would have done these two things together, but we have to spend the wayfinding money by March 29th and we'll be ready for the downtown study. So we're sort of thinking them together with the two separate projects.
Any questions or comments on that?
In particular, the work on crosswalks sounds very exciting, and the rest of it too. Thank you. And you have nothing else to add about data gathering for other crosswalks. You sort of answered that in your
right. Right. We're really going to turn this over to Alton.
Let's see. We have visitors here for a number of other subjects. They're thorny subjects. So before we start discussing them, I'll just say I do not expect us to reach a conclusion on them, just to be perfectly honest with you. So I'd like to jump to just a quick follow-up on issues related to downtown parking. To parking in downtown Florence. We had a number of visitors last meeting, and we said we'd follow up after gathering some data. So the first thing I'd ask is, I don't know if the DPW, I know there's transitions going on within the DPW. I'm not sure if the DPW was able to find any data from the past that we discussed at our last meeting about parking downtown Florence.
We have not been able to find the
PVPC
study yet.
Okay.
I did request from PVPC get a copy of that study.
Okay.
So I have not seen it.
Okay. Thank you. Since there are members of the public here, I would ask if anyone would like the opportunity to speak on this item.
I'm Peter Newsom, the owner of 47 Chestnut Street in Florence. I spoke at the last meeting. If you've got no data, then there's no point in saying anything else, is there? So is there a potential time scale as to how we're looking at 2 months, 3 months?
I would say that, since it's such a complicated issue, many different possible things we might do to address the issue. I don't know, other than it's something I would like to bring back up in January and continue to look at it.
There's nothing's changed, so I know the hours of one of the businesses has changed, the my shop right on the corner there. They're now opening later, but they're staying open later, as I understand. So there we go, that's about it, as I understand that. So traffic's only going to get more, isn't it? More and more people have cars and so forth, so it's going to be a thorny issue for some time, unfortunately.
It's never comforting to hear. We appreciate your diligence and we're definitely
taking it seriously, but we appreciate your diligence and we're definitely taking it seriously.
Right, yeah. Just a quick 30 seconds. They did a traffic study in London in 1926 when all the things were horse and carts. It was 11 miles an hour. They did the same thing in the 80s. It was still 11 miles an hour. They did another one about 10 years ago. It got down 4 miles an hour. So, unfortunately, that's the way things are going. Anyway, thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you very much. Anything else on this topic?
I did meet with parking enforcement and walked all of that area with parking enforcement to check the signs and also to review the parking ordinances for those general areas in Pine Street, Middle, Chestnut, that whole area of Maine. So there has been greater attention to that area.
Okay. Well, we appreciate you doing that.
You know, hopefully that will have some impact on it.
Basically in terms of monitoring, not in terms of... Okay.
Right.
Excellent. Okay, any other comments on this? Okay. We should also do a follow-up on parking issues near Burt's Pit Road. Thank you to Maggie Chan for going out and doing an assessment of the area. Last meeting, we talked about bringing an actual ordinance to prohibit parking at that length, and I have not put that on the agenda for this particular meeting. And I think it's something that we're going to have to continue into the future and have a little bit more conversation about, because you know, doing a site visit, I have questions about, frankly, how often it's a problem. I know we had a photograph submitted from a resident on a Friday, and looking into it a little bit, I'm wondering if the easiest solution might not be to talk to the high school when they have sports events at that location and ask them to modify their parking behavior, since that photograph did come on a Friday when I believe that's what was happening. So that's how I feel on that. We don't have the ordinance in front of us, and I think we just need more discussion going forward.
Can I provide an update?
Please do. Thank you.
Melissa Nadelman, I live on Burt's Pit Road, and you may remember what he's talking about is on either side of Sunset Hill. One side of Sunset Hill is curved in by the unofficial dog park, and the other side is over towards where the barns are, where the compost is. And Smith location, Jeff Peterson has installed signage on the side where his compost project is going to be, on the barn side. That's the furthest away from town. And that's the area where the county, I'm going to say jail, but that's the wrong word.
Correction.
Thank you very much. That is, as I understand, one of their emergency egresses to Burt's Pit Road. The gate there has been upgraded significantly, and they've put signage there, which is right at that curve point. And so they've got no parking, no trespassing. They've also bermed up the area on either side of the gate and put boulders in an attempt to keep people off of that particular area. Additionally, directly across from where the correctional facility has installed their signage, Jeff has put up one indicating that there is keep out, no trespassing, you need to be authorized for both vehicles and footpath. So the neighbors on the Burt's Pit Road have made a concerted effort through flyers with Jeff's approval to update people that if they're using the property, they need to be parking in the parking area, unofficially known as the dog park, and not parking on those curves for their safety and for the safety of others. The photos were absolutely taken off the worst case scenario. The majority of the traffic is occurring when there is an event that is sanctioned by Smith Vocational, and Jeff has agreed to make sure that the people that are using the property with his permission are made aware of the fact that they should not be parking on the road. He's got a little work to do there, but he's also got signs up. The other time that occurs is not a Smith Vogue sanctioned activity, and that's on the weekends when people are using not just the parking lot, even if there's availability for parking spaces, they're actually parking on the road. So I completely concur that that's the thing that we'll need to keep some vigilance towards, so that there are not problems, because it is
I think I heard the term farm road today, where there's no curbing and no sides and certain parts kind of drop off. And Burt's Pit Road in that area is a farm road. In other words, it's completely paved, but it doesn't have curbing or anything like that. One of the questions he had, this will be Jeff Peterson, is whether the boulders that are where the trees used to be, perhaps you remember from your site visit? Whether, because he's not sure where the road is and where it's responsibility, so he's reluctant to move the boulders closer to the road, which would stop people from parking along that area that's right on either side. So is that something that you could find that information out for him? Or is how would I proceed with that back to him?
It's been surveyed, but I don't know if it's monumented or not. So I have surveys in my office.
Oh, excellent.
But again, where the monuments are on the ground. I know where the line is in the paper, but I don't know where it is on the ground.
Right.
Well,
maybe the students would like to find that out. I mean, that's part of what they're doing. And there is student activity other than just, you know, running. I mean, he has his agricultural people up there as well as his forestry people. So maybe that would be a great student project. I don't know. I'll make that suggestion to him and see what he says.
I've let him lawn work, too, that they could, you know.
Yeah.
But maybe it's a conversation, I think, as you're suggesting, that we continue offline and
okay.
To make that determination.
Yeah, I'm certainly open to that, and we have seen a reduction in traffic since the signage has gone up, even though that's not city signage, because of course, it's his understanding that those people are not authorized to use property, so they shouldn't be parking there because there's nothing else there within a quarter mile.
Well, we appreciate that update, actually. It's very informative, and actually it sounds like there's some...
I was providing pictures of the improvements.
Okay.
So, thank you very much for your time. I appreciate it.
Any questions from Ms. Norman?
Just one question.
Yeah.
So the field is this, you guys have the right to close to public. The Drumlin itself is public access. So.
Not to the best of my knowledge.
And the conservation restriction.
The state Department of Agriculture, that said, and again, this is just what I learned, so that the entire 250 acres is all agricultural only underneath.
We can go offline. We have a conservation restriction on the Drumlin and within 100 feet of Mill River. Those two places.
Yes. Right, because they were talking about you because, not you personally, access to the river is one of the reasons why people are using the property.
Right.
And so what came up in one of the quarterly conversations was, okay, who is responsible for this piece here and that kind of thing. So the Drumlin
is
also...
Drumlin's the same thing.
Ah.
Above some elevation sea level, I don't know what it's all in here, but basically it's jungle.
Okay, I'll let him know that because I'm not sure if he's aware of it.
Okay.
Because that's an area where the fences have broken down and he wants to reinstate pasture, but the bittersweet has grown in and it's got to do with goats and
thank you very much.
Not really on the meeting, but not personal, but whatever.
Item number 14, South Street bicycle pedestrian improvements. And I would just ask Councilor Sharrock if this is something you'd like to tackle at this time, or it's obviously a complicated subject, and we certainly could do it at a future meeting, but it's up to you.
I invite me to do it just between other agenda items.
Okay. I would suggest you do that because it's a complicated issue. I would ask. Unless there's any objection, we continue the rest of the items except for one. Items 14, 8, 11, 12, 13, 15, 16, and 19 to our next regular meeting. Is there any objection to doing that?
Question,
what
time
is
it? No, I'm on the Human Rights Commission. This is the wrong commission.
You go right ahead.
What time does your meeting end?
Pardon me?
What time is this meeting over?
Definitely be over at 6.
Oh.
Yeah.
Just wondering, I thought you were like over in like 10 minutes.
Any objection to postponing those items to the next meeting?
Okay.
We'll postpone them then without objection. The remaining item is I've invited Jasper Lapiansky to make a presentation to us. He's a member of the Franklin Regional Transit Authority's Transit Advisory Committee, newly appointed. And he made a brief presentation to the City Council in public comment, but I thought he could share some thoughts with us tonight. Mr. Lapiansky, if you would.
Yes, that was one of my
least well understood public comments, and I should have done better, as you probably thought to yourself after it. People then went up and the next public comment said that I was something else. So I've just put together a little bullet point list of things that I think I ought to say. So the FRTA is one of the smallest and least well-funded transportation agencies in Massachusetts, and that's because it serves a rural area with very little population, and because, as everyone in Western Mass likes to say, they get discriminated against by the Bostonians, and I have no evidence one way or the other, but it very well might be true. Right now, it operates a handful of what they call fixed route service, which is what most of us would refer to as just a bus route. So there's a route that goes from Greenfield to Orange, and it stops in Turner's Falls, Miller's Falls, Irving, and then goes through Orange, and it goes to a shopping center on the border between Orange and Athol. There's obviously the Northampton route, and that stops in various places in South Deerfield, and then it goes along Route 5 through Waitley and Hatfield. Stops at Northampton Big Y, and then it comes down to the Academy of Music to connect with all of the buses from PBTA that are in this area. There's a route that goes in loops around Greenfield, and you can literally be on it for an hour to get from one place to another in Greenfield. There is a route that goes up to Sheldon Falls and then Charlemont, and it serves a few schools in that area, also Sheldon Falls. And then, of course, there's the Montague and Amherst route, which is, they call it two different routes, but they work essentially as a team. There's no overlap in time, and that goes through Turner's Falls and Miller's Falls, loops its way around Montague, and then goes down through Leverett to go to UMass. When I say bus routes, they're fixed. They do the same thing at the same time. None of them operates more than seven times in a day. That would be Orange. The Northampton route operates six times a day. They only operate Monday through Friday. They don't operate on any holidays, and they also don't operate on things that none of the rest of us think are holidays, like President's Day and Patriot's Day and Columbus Day. In other words, there's a very small amount of service, but that's what they have the money for, and obviously they're always working on improvements, but as with any government agency, most of those improvements are dependent on money that never arrives. So there's also something that all Massachusetts transportation agencies do, which is they provide on-demand van service to people with disabilities for, I think it's a $3 fare, and for the most part they'll take them anywhere within a certain radius of regular bus stops. And unlike PBTA, this is it with such a small system, that's a lot of what they do. Almost all of the drivers, if not all of the drivers that drive for FRTA, do some of that on-demand service, because that's just what there is. They can't get up to 40 hours a week without that. And they do, that is the only part of FRTA that does anything on weekends. They won't take you to a friend's house on a weekend with that service, but they will take you to a doctor's appointment if your doctor's open on the weekend. The problem with smartphones is they time out very quickly. So starting this coming year, there's going to be, they haven't gotten any extra money yet, but they are implementing some changes to their routes and their fares. The one that's going to be relevant to us, starting January 1st, all routes are going to be $1.25. Right now, the Greenfield bus from Northampton costs $1.50. So it's going to be changed so that it's the same price as all of the rest of the buses in Northampton, which is $1.25 for one ride. At this point, FRTA does not offer day passes. They don't offer monthly passes. They're working on that. And then for people with disabilities, also for high school students, the fare will be 60 cents instead of 125, which is the closest they can get to half So I wanted to very briefly touch on who the stakeholders are. Just like any transportation agency, there's the towns that have representatives on the advisory board. A lot of towns don't have any bus service, and so that becomes, to a certain extent, it starts to feel arbitrary. So for instance, Southampton is part of FRTA, West Hampton is part of PBTA. Neither of them have any service. Neither of them are ever going to have any service. Actually, technically, Southampton has one stop from PBTA, but they still participate in FRTA. Granville, Massachusetts, which is near Southwick, is also part of FRTA. It must have been a coin flip for them. Some schools also are stakeholders. GCC does not give them any money, but over half of the riders of the entire FRTA system at any given time are current students at GCC. And so there's always tension between them of that, but GCC doesn't like to talk to them because the response they get is, well, you really should be paying into the system the way everyone else is. The Academy at Charlemont is a small private school, and they actually pay for the run to Charlemont, along with, there's a small assessment to Shelburne and Buckland, or possibly not Buckland anymore, because the route was discontinued from going to Buckland, but essentially that's what provides for that service. Is there's this private school in Charlemont that really wants them to go there. And then of course there's the administration, which is relatively small. Drivers, all of the drivers work for a company called First Transit, which does business as, I believe it's the Franklin, forget exactly, it's Franklin Transit Company or something like that. And it's the same as, there's a state law in Massachusetts that transportation agencies cannot employ anyone who drives a bus, which is, I think that's unfortunate, but that's something at the state level. Nobody around here can do anything about that. And then there's the riders who ride the bus like myself and pay the fares and annoy the hell out of them sometimes when we say what we'd like to have. That brings me to number three on my list, which is the Transit Advisory Committee. This is not the same thing as the advisory board, which is the governing body of any regional transit authority. So the Transit Advisory Committee, I'm not aware of similar entities on other transportation agencies. This is something that the administrator of FRTA put together at some point in the past. I don't know how long it's been going on for. It's a purely advisory body, and what it does is it's intended to be a liaison between Tina Cote and the public. It does a lot of other things too. It does marketing, which is their word for trying to get more people to ride the bus. For instance, 2 days a year they do free service on all of their fixed routes, which typically does not net a lot of new riders, because for instance, one of them is Black Friday, when a lot of people are not working and nobody's going to school, and most of the people who ride FRTA are either students or they're taking the bus to work. But it also does other kinds of outreach. I'm imagining trying to do some work with, like, for instance, Greenfield High School. A lot of high school students in Greenfield would like to go and do things after school, and I wonder how many of them have the ability to take the bus there. And, of course, trying to work with GCC would be a really good thing. Advocacy for riders is one of our roles. And by the way, not everyone who's on the Transit Advisory Committee takes the bus. That's not a requirement. The idea is that they represent the community somehow. One of the city councilors at large in Greenfield, Penny Ricketts, is the chair of the committee. Then representation. And that's going to bring me to number four, which is Northampton. But I wanted to make sure to tell all of you when we meet, which is the second Thursday of every odd numbered month. So January, March, May, etc. And that's at 1 o'clock, and that's at the JWO Transit Center in Greenfield. It's a big rust-colored building, it's kind of hard to miss, and I don't know why Walt Patrick wanted to have it designed that way, but he did a big ribbon-cutting ceremony, so he must have been happy. The reason that I think that this purely advisory committee has some role to play in Northampton is because Northampton doesn't have a representative on their actual advisory board. There's discussion in the state legislature right now about changing this, but each city or town can only be part of one regional transit authority, even if it's served by two. So Northampton has two of FRTA's most used bus stops, has a lot of people who live in Northampton, proportionally speaking to the amount of people that take these buses, right? I mean, there's more people on most individual bus runs that leave Northampton for Amherst than there are that take the bus to Greenfield in a week, but it's a high percentage, right? So Northampton doesn't have a representative that goes there. One of the things that I'm going to do here tonight is offer to be that representative. I have to be there at least six times a year. This committee was deliberately convened by the administration, and so obviously they're interested in what we have to say. Yes.
I think that brings us to kind of the central question. If we can we turn it over to questions now, so we can.
Yes, that was exactly what that was the next thing that I was going to say. I only had one other, which was as far as going the other direction. I would like to see some possible work with this committee as far as establishing more places where the bus can stop, because right now we only have Big Y, the PVTA bus stop in front of Leah Honda, Sirio's Market, and the Academy of Music, and there's no other places that FRTA has been given the go-ahead to stop at, even though PVTA stops at other places. So that's how it would work in the other directions. I'd like to work with this committee on that.
Right.
That's the end of what I had thought to say.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
And I would love to have some questions.
Very informative. And are there any questions at this time? I would just say, I mean, it does seem like at the end, you got to how it affects Northampton. And I do think it is important for us to think about regional transit. And we'd be interested in whatever materials or other information you could send to me, and I'd be happy to send it to the commission.
What kind of materials are you looking for?
Well, I don't know. I guess I'll ask one question I'd ask, and then I think we have to wrap the meeting up pretty soon. But I mean, what do you think? How would Northampton go about strengthening its regional transit system through the FRTA? In terms of adding more buses, bus stops, this kind of thing. Is there an established protocol where the FRTA talks to our PVTA, or how would that work?
I don't think that PVTA, so, I mean, yes, hypothetically speaking, ideally there could be bus stops where they both stop.
Mm-hmm.
It's not clear to me that it has to work that way.
Mm-hmm.
Because of course they issue their own bus stop signs, and bus stop signs aren't required for a bus to stop. In both cases along the King Street corridor, it's mostly just an agreement between the drivers and the passengers as far as where they can get picked up. Calvin Theater, for instance, PVTA stops in front of the Calvin on the south side of Merrick Lane, or whatever that's called. FRTA stops on the north side of it, even though PVTA has one of their primary bus stops there. They won't do it. So it could be that there's communication between the two. To be honest, I'm not really sure how to facilitate that, because I find PVTA to be extremely hard to communicate with. Although if Wayne Feigen was still here, I might be able to address that a little better. But I think that the two entities that could really be easily worked with as far as FRTA is concerned, the police department saying, well, it's safe to stop here. So I think Chief Casper might have a thing to say in that as far as locations, because the big thing for FRTA is safety, and most of those people don't really hang out in Northampton very much. And then the other thing is, you know, whoever's in charge of streets, so DPW, transportation and parking, if there was something from Northampton that said, it's okay if you stop in this particular place, and here are the departments that say that's okay.
Okay.
They have bus stop signs they can put up.
Thank you. Are there any other thoughts or questions for Mr. Lapansky? I think you're witnessing the end of, you're seeing some fatigue here from a lot of
people. I'm aware of that, and I just wanted to deliver a message from the assistant administrator, which is to please contact him if you have any questions that you want to work with directly with him, and I want to provide that, which is pretty simple. It's michael@frta.org. If someone could put that in the meeting minutes so that everyone has that. And, you know,
excellent.
Anyone who thinks they have a stake in it is invited to our next meeting, which is January 14th at 1 o'clock.
That's excellent. And
where is that at?
JWO Transit Center. I said that earlier, so I didn't. And that's like 12 Olive Street, I want to say, I think is the address.
Okay, well, we definitely appreciate your update, and it's something that we should focus on more in the future, perhaps.
And if I have anything specific, I might try to revisit it.
Certainly welcome. Thank you very much.
Yep.
I think that takes care of our agenda. Is there any new business for today? Is there a motion to adjourn?
Motion to adjourn.
Mr. Pomerantz makes a motion. Mr. Brennan seconds. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Thank you very much.